Sickle cell disease is a condition that affects many in sub-Saharan Africa. In Kenya, this disease is common in the Western and Nyanza region. It's a disease that comes with psychological, emotional, and financial toll to many families. Today, we have the privilege of talking to a mom who's a caregiver of sicklers, and she's also an advocate of sickle cell disease. That's none other than Dr. Josephine Ojiambo. Daktari, karibu sana to this conversation.
Thank you very much, Mercy. Yes. Delighted to be here.
Good to see you. We know sickle cell, and when people hear about sickle cell, and we've had this conversation with you, people think, oh no, my child will not live to, you know, to their best years. They'll not live to adulthood. What has been your experience?
Thank you for that question. Underneath it belies a lot of learning, challenges, joy, and indeed tears. Mm-hmm. So I'll speak about my personal experience. I am a caregiver. I am a mother of two with sickle cell anemia. We call them warriors. That's a term that we coined at home and with those who we were close to, mm-hmm. because they live, that is a sickle cell child, adult. They live days where they need to face great health challenge as well as social challenge. Mm-hmm. But they do this with lots of courage. So we have coined them warriors. So I'll use the word warriors to tell you about my experience. My firstborn, a son, Peter, passed on 5 years ago due to complications of sickle cell anemia. I want to say that over the years since the children were born, there's been a lot of learning in Kenya and abroad on the management of sickle cell anemia. And what bedeviled us 5 years ago may not bedevil us today. Mm-hmm. We've learned that over a period of time, that despite the early teachings, that transfusions may not be necessarily beneficial for a routine, indeed, admission of a sickler or presentation, that more and more, it's important that you do give red blood cells to the sickler. Mm-hmm. And so as a result, when in yesteryear we would withhold a transfusion, today we see that transfusions are the mainstay. Mm-hmm. We've also learned, and this is my experience, that screening, neonatal screening is important. Mm-hmm. I was able to have my children screened early because my physician, Dr. Alwatch at that time, had a high index of suspicion that this may be sickle cell anemia. And as a result, we had specimens taken and flown out of the country, tested, and the result came back. Today, we are able mm-hmm. to have a sickle scan very easily done within minutes, mm-hmm. and we're able to do an electrophoresis. Mm-hmm. And early on in life, a parent would know whether the child has sickle cell anemia.
Being a doctor, was it any easier, any better for you to understand and know how to manage your children?
Yes, it was, because I have a basic understanding of the science behind the condition. Many times in the wards, I would speak a gentle word to a physician and say, if you do this now, the outcome will be better sooner. Mm-hmm. I'm able to also understand how to give an adequate nutrition to the children, which many perhaps without the understanding of what is required to keep the red blood cell strong wouldn't do. Mm-hmm. Yet, I want to say that it's not only myself who has learned, that there is more learning that's taking place also for physicians in general. So that as a body of professions, not just the physicians, the nurses, the clinical officers, we can all give better care to the warrior. Mm-hmm. But I want to say that for me, being a mom and being a physician has helped. But this information that we so are blessed to have should be passed on to all parents, mm-hmm. so they too have a better chance to give quality to the days of their children.
Mm-hmm. I notice from talking to many moms and parents whose children have sickle cell disease that the finger is always pointed at the woman, that, you know, the woman is the one who's at fault for this illness. And then on top of that, it's the woman who actually bears the brunt of it all, being in hospital, you know, sleepless nights. Was it the same for you?
Definitely. It's interesting that the body of knowledge is just growing today. Mm-hmm. And though many of us come from a Nairobi city type setting, mm-hmm. and perhaps from backgrounds where we have more education, still mm-hmm. people said, you made a wrong choice. You married into the wrong community. They said, this is you who has brought a bad condition on yourself. Those comments are not necessarily helpful because mm-hmm. they translate to the children and create challenges with self-esteem. But it's important that a mother therefore continues to bring up her children, giving them confidence and supporting their aspirations. Mm-hmm. But more than that, in our traditional setting with the gender imbalance, then it's worse for women who in the rural area perhaps do not have the same education, the same empowerment, the same ability to make a decision to take her child to hospital when she feels it's right. Mm-hmm. For those women, they are ostracized. Many are chased away from home, and they are chased away with children who need care and sent to a place where there may not be even a roof over their heads and those of their children. Over the years, I've been able to engage with women in those settings. And you find in their disempowered setting, they're challenged to give care to their children. It's important that when we look at guidelines for managing sickle cell, we look at the psychosocial context mm-hmm. of the caregiver. Mm-hmm. Because many times, they're the most vulnerable, yet they're doing the greatest, greatest duty. Mm-hmm. It's important that the caregiver is empowered because the warrior depends on this caregiver. Mm-hmm. So I agree with you. This is an area that we need to review and look at what's happening to those women who require care. Mm-hmm. In many settings, there's been attempts to provide small and micro enterprise to women in the western region of the country, focusing on those that are most vulnerable and have duties to give care. Mm-hmm. And sickle cell is one that requires that. We've had attempts to do that for HIV and AIDS. Mm-hmm. It's important that we start looking at sickle cell and provide care and empowerment for women in those settings mm-hmm. in Western Kenya and along the coast mm-hmm. of Kenya on the Indian Ocean shores. Mm-hmm. This is where we very important.
Okay. Let's talk a bit about your children. You said previously that they have taught you or you've learned some things from them. What are they?
First of all, I've learned not to take things too seriously because they are such a bundle of joy. I say they. My son is deceased, but during his days, the house would always be full with other youngsters that he was teaching information, communication, and technology. He was a computer geek. Because sicklers are not able to engage in heavy physical activity, they tend to be the more intellectual amongst us, sitting many hours as they would do today behind the computer. Mm-hmm. And so therefore, from his learnings, he would always have others around him he was empowering. For him, he saw a generation of young people empowered by technology, and that was his drive. And so I've learned, because mm-hmm. of him, to keep engaging with young people. And we've put together a foundation in his name, the Peter Odhiambo Foundation, that now looks at empowering youngsters with technology. We've put in place an ICT lab in Westlands Primary. We're putting in place an ICT lab in Busia, our home. And on those computers, we are putting in place computer packages called EduPendent, education independently. For those who can't get to school, because sicklers spend many days away from formal settings such as school because of illness, mm-hmm. so that you can continue to learn from whatever base you can access. Mm-hmm. So I've learned that from my son. From my daughter, Marie, whom you know as your classmate.
Yes.
Marie is in diaspora in the United States of America. Mm-hmm. Marie is a pharmacist with a specialty in drug development and design. Mm-hmm. She's a senior scientist at a drug company in Big Pharma on the East Coast of the US, where she formulates drugs. She therefore is a formulation scientist. Mm-hmm. She uses her intellect to make new drugs and to review the efficacy of drugs on the market. Mm-hmm. She's a model. Mm. Maria models and has been Miss Kenya USA. And anything she gets from the proceeds of modeling go towards social support groups for sicklers. Mm-hmm. About 6 years ago, Maria started a sickle cell support group called Ongea. Ongea was a dream that she and her brother held. They wanted to have other sicklers gather routinely to talk, to spit out their challenges, mm-hmm. and to have their caregivers also spit out their challenges of being caregivers. And so they put it together and dubbed it Ongea. We've had 6 years of Ongea. Ongea in Nairobi, supported by Safaricom. Ongea in Western Kenya at the Tom Mboya Labour College, where we celebrated Peter's passing. Ongea in Mombasa, Ongea in Migori, where we had puppetry and used puppets to animate a message which would have been socially, I might say, not easy for the community to understand, but the puppets could speak about sickle cell and families could listen. We continue to have Ongea. From this spirit of social support that my daughter has embedded in me, we've been able to now do it online. And so during the COVID era, we've had more social support groups meeting online. Mm-hmm. So there you are. Those are my learnings.
Yes. So you mentioned that it's important to build self-esteem in children who are sickle cell warriors. Is it because now we are seeing the end product of your work, but what did it take such that your children, despite having sickle cell disease, have been able to, you know, do even better than children who may not have sickle cell disease?
Thank you. It's been a dedication. It's been a walk where every day I've been able to subjugate my personal desires as a physician mm-hmm. to excel, so that I can carry along with me the needs of my children, because they did need special care. As a physician, it meant sometimes not being on the ward, but not in an irresponsible manner, but speaking out and saying, I do need to take care of my children at this point. It's also meant for them to be able, when they could, to communicate early when they felt unwell. Mm-hmm. And over time, with them being trained in listening to their own bodies, they are more able, and all sicklers are, to say, I'm not feeling well. But it's also meant that I have been able to watch them, and when they withdraw, understand that that withdrawal is because there is pain. Mm-hmm. It's been a lesson about learning how to spot an infection and take them for care early so that it doesn't spiral into a sickle cell crisis. It's been a learning on how to communicate with the family so that they understand this is not a curse. It's not a taboo. It is the result of genes, a gene pool that all of us come from. No one is necessarily without this gene or genetic trait amongst our community. And therefore, we should not be singled out for ostracization. It's meant a lot of discussion in the community when we go home for functions, holidays, bringing together others in the community so they could speak together and then share the challenge and support each other together.
Stigma often stops people from openly discussing and engaging because, as you say, there's always finger pointing and blame games around. How do you then overcome the issue of stigma and being able to boldly speak up and speak about sickle cell?
It's difficult to beat stigma, but you know, the warrior has to learn to communicate. Sometimes, like a child, we go and visit another for a sleepover, and in the middle of the night fall unwell because they have no advance warning that they're going to go into crisis, and probably they've been playing and having a good time. How do they beat stigma? By speaking out and saying, I don't feel well. Mm-hmm. I have a problem. And those who are positively inclined will listen, and instead of stigmatization, employ skills to support the sickler through this particular setting. Mm-hmm. But stigma still exists, and there are times when, because this communication takes place, the recipient of the message acts in a negative, unsupporting manner. Mm-hmm. And that's where the stigma starts. But as a parent, one continues to give care and support. But children grow, and when they become adults, you sometimes need a second pair of hands. And that's where not only social support groups, but psychosocial counseling mm-hmm. is important. Mm-hmm. This is important because the complications of sickle cell come with the need for pain medication. Over periods of time, it appears addictive in certain settings. Over periods of time, they lose out on school and their achievements. These things sometimes need more than just a pat on the back, but actually need counsel. Mm-hmm. They need others to come in and in a very professional way mm-hmm. provide the support required. Mm-hmm. One would call these mental health interventions. I want us to understand that having a mental health intervention doesn't mean you're crazy or cuckoo. It just means you need support. And it's important that we learn that we can call to the mental health practitioner mm-hmm. and get the support we need. Mm-hmm. Children move away into different settings. Whereas a telephone call and a Zoom call works today, in different settings, they're going to have to call on professionals to give them the support they need. Mm-hmm. I have been open enough to support my children to reach for care when they need to.
Mm-hmm. And the stigma is not always just even with outside the home setting. Sometimes it's even your partner, your spouse, who is stigmatizing you. And we've seen strained relationships, marriages are even breaking up, you know, because of this. How do women navigate that?
It's a challenge, isn't it?
Because mm-hmm. sometimes that is all that you have, because as you said, if you get out of the home setting, then you're out in the streets.
It's a challenge. And as much as it looks like it's heavily biased towards the women, mm-hmm. the question could be asked for men. How do they navigate this? Mm-hmm. There are settings where we have found men who have been left alone as single parents taking care of warriors. We've met three recently in Nairobi, mm-hmm. one in Dandora and two others. The one in Dandora alone, his wife left him and remarried. She felt he was the reason why their children, not one but two, had sickle cell anemia. Mm-hmm. The other two are taking on a larger responsibility of caregiving, but the spouse is present with them. So the challenge sometimes cuts both ways, but more often for the woman. Mm-hmm. And for this woman, like I've said, the ability to communicate what's going on is important. But that can only happen if there has been pre-marriage counseling mm-hmm. and testing, so that a couple getting into a union, particularly if they come from Western Kenya or coast and have had a discussion or heard within the family that there have been children who passed away in young age because of what necessarily was not diagnosed but could have been sickle cell, it's great to have premarital counseling mm-hmm. and do all your genotype indications. Look at all the genetics behind the two of you coming together. That's important. But beyond that, the ability of the mother to care for the children, to know what diets to give them, to watch for the signs of an impending crisis, to keep them warm and away from extreme weather, to make sure that they're adequately hydrated and always have a bottle of water tucked away in their bags, to tell them to call out when they feel ill, and to do so early enough. Mm-hmm. There are stories about this dragon, the sickle cell evil that comes at night and steals children in the depths of the night. So if a child is able to say in the daytime, "Mommy, I don't feel well," there'll be nobody at home saying, "You always disturb us to get up at night to take the child to hospital." Mm-hmm. You know, those kind of things a woman needs to understand how to speak about. And because all of this is shrouded in mystery, one of the things that I am involved in right now is putting together of a movie, mm-hmm. a movie created by our colleagues in Nigeria with Nollywood actors together with Kenyan actors from Riverwood, speaking about mzigo, mm-hmm. the heavy burden that women bear because of the sickle cell trait and anemia. And this movie speaks about young people getting married and talks about the way young people are received by their parents, particularly if your choice of spouse is a sickle cell warrior, someone who lives positively with sickle cell anemia. And we, in that movie, depict the challenges for two young people getting together, knowing that one of them is a warrior. But not only that, their offspring. How do they get through school? That's another challenge. How are teachers prepared to handle sickle cell? Mm-hmm. Does our education system prepare them? We have prepared our teachers not too recently, in the recent past, to handle COVID and hand washing. Mm-hmm. Are we preparing the education system, particularly in Western Kenya and the coast, to handle the child with sickle cell who invariably will fall behind because they're not able to be in class every day, who can't go out there and swim or go to track? I remember when my daughter would come home and say, "But mommy, the teacher's forcing me to go to track." And I'd have to go after school and tell the teacher, "My daughter can't. Kindly let her remain on the side or allow her to continue in class doing other things." But the teachers would think, "No, it's not true. This is your excuse for your child not coming out. But you need to keep talking." So there are various challenges, and even to the youngster as they grow, to tell them, listen, you can't take another long night in the disco. Come home. And they'd say, Mom, you're overdoing it. You're too protective. But when they do go out and spend the whole night there, the next week they're in bed, unable to perform their normal duties. Mm-hmm. So some of it is lessons learned. Others, it's advance warning to the child. Mm-hmm. All of this must be blended by the caregiver, who principally is a mother.
Is a mother. So there's a lot of learnings, a lot of things for the caregiver. It could be the mother most of the time, to know about their child or children, because there are families, you know, with several children with sickle cell disease, and that's a lot. So do support groups and other partnerships play a key role to help parents navigate through this?
Yes, support groups and other partnerships do. Some of them can be very granular engagements to support another caregiver. Mm-hmm. I recall not too long ago, a lady who lost her second child to sickle cell. I was called on with a warrior who traveled all the way from Kampala to come in. So we have partnered with warriors across the border. Mm-hmm. The Kabaka in Uganda has an annual event where people turn out in droves wearing dark red t-shirts with this ribbon like I'm wearing because of sickle cell and for sickle cell, and walk to support sicklers. It's an advocacy drive, but as a result, we partnered with them and they send their warriors over to support us. And so at a funeral service at home for a lady who'd lost two children, I remember her standing next to the coffin, the casket of her son. And she was crying, but she was crying out the name of a child who had passed on 2 years ago. And I asked her, I said, Mama, your child is not called Henry, this child is Susan. And she said to me, no, Henry keeps coming back. This is Henry born again, and he's passed on yet again. There are needs to partner to give psychosocial counseling and support to caregivers. Mm-hmm. But you can imagine what the life may have been for the child who also grew up in the shadow of another child who had passed on. Mm-hmm. So there's need to partner with support groups for the warriors themselves. Mm-hmm. And today we have the Sickle Cell Federation in Kenya that is a federation, an umbrella for the many sickle cell organizations that exist, mm-hmm. where there is support for children and support for caregivers. Mm-hmm. We also have the Kenya Hemophilia Association, a great association putting in place clinics across the country, initially for hemophilia. Mm-hmm. But what they're doing is amazing. They're bringing the cost of drugs down, because warriors require daily medications, folic acid, paludrine to prevent malaria, and now hydroxyurea, yes, to reduce the frequency of the crisis. Mm-hmm. They're partnering with families, with communities, to bring the cost of those drugs down, to make them more affordable. And they're providing, wherever they go and can, clinics to give special care once a week or more if possible, for warriors who require that care. Mm-hmm. But we also have brought on board the greatest partner, the Ministry of Health. It was a joy when 2 years ago we could celebrate the annual Sickle Cell Day with the ministry. Their support has just been amazing. We have a lady called Gladwell Gadesha in the Ministry of Health headquarters, whose duty it is to care for the many sicklers in our community. Not so long ago, I was given an award. I am now a sickle cell champion for Kenya. Mm-hmm. I want to say, for us, the recognition that this special group needs support, care, is something that we will commend our ministry for many days. The ministry, standing with us, has brought other partners to the table. Mm-hmm. Now we have private sector. We have Novartis at our side, mm-hmm. giving us support not just for treatment, care, and medication, but also for advocacy and awareness creation. Mm-hmm. And we've been able to go online and speak to partners in academic settings across the globe, in West Africa at the universities, mm-hmm. in London with King's College, in Jamaica with the University of the West Indies. Mm-hmm. And as a result of online interventions, we're bringing now intellectual people together to see how we can improve the lives of our warriors.
To imagine that this is a disease that it still is shrouded in a bit of mystery, as you called it. Some traditional healers and healing and, you know, traditional ways of managing it. Would the guidelines or this progress reduce those traditional ways that really do not help much to make the life of a sickler better?
Yes, the guidelines do speak a little bit about things that tradition has held as mm-hmm. practice that shouldn't be held. But before I go to that, I also want to say that some of our traditions and cultures, even not knowing, were useful. Mm-hmm. Useful. You would know that in certain communities, even in Kenya, and I say this because I'm looking at it globally, mm-hmm. we are told not to marry first cousins or second cousins. Yeah. It's a tradition. You're mm-hmm. told you can't marry from that clan. Mm-hmm. They're your relatives. And youngsters say, ah, what's all this about the clan? But the issue here isn't just the clan. It's because genetic markers or the genotype associated with sickle cell and other conditions is, of course, prevalent within communities that have relationships that are familial. Mm-hmm. So that may have been a tradition where you are told, you know, find out what clan they belong to. But it was useful mm-hmm. when it comes to stopping the passage of a particular genotype. Mm-hmm. And we know that the genotype is, you'd say, the blueprint for whatever comes out in one's physical mm-hmm. form. Beyond that, now we have science that can tell us about right nutritional practice so that we have better protein available in diet and therefore better outcomes with red blood cells and the carrying of oxygen in the body. We now have science to tell us that the sickle requires hydration. Mm. We have science in these modules to tell you about intravenous therapy, infusions, and the use of red blood cells mm-hmm. and the use of other parts of serum to support the sickle. All of this is because of the advancing of science. But I want to go back to your question. You asked a little bit about stigma and tradition. Mm-hmm. And I want to say that as much as we are a very forward community, we need to also break it down so that we are no longer saying that is a disease of Western Kenya mm-hmm. or a disease of coast, because our children, unlike us, will marry across many borders, boundaries, and communities, and genetic material is carried in that manner. Our children will live abroad, will study abroad, and they will marry into other communities, and they will carry genetic markers into those communities. And therefore, sickle cell today exists in Europe. Mm-hmm. And so we need to also use science to reduce stigma in Europe so that those who have the condition there get care without being labeled as, look at this African disease presenting amongst us. Who is it here who married somebody from mm-hmm. Africa? Mm-hmm. And across in the United States of America, we need to share the same information so that sicklers there, who may be Kenyans living in diaspora, also get care without being labeled as, look, this African disease has come to find itself manifested here in the United States of America. So science is important, and we need to keep speaking out.
Mm-hmm. There's a lot indeed to keep talking about sickle cell disease, and obviously until it is what I call mainstreamed into our everyday lives, we'll still continue talking about it. Thank you very much, Dr. Ari, for your time and for sharing your, you know, personal experiences, what you think can be done and should be done. And, you know, we wish you all the very best as a sickle cell champion, and we hope that, you know, we get to a better place as a country. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mercy.
Thank you very much for staying with us. We have been having a conversation with Dr. Josephine Ojiambo, who's a caregiver. She's a sickle cell champion. And we've been talking about, you know, the advances that we've made in sickle cell, issues of stigma, issues of treatment, diagnosis, and how sickle cell disease has broken beyond the traditional borders that we know. Stay with us as we continue having this month-long conversation on sickle cell disease. My name is Dr. Mercy Korir.